Welcome to today's class. Today our subject is strength of material. In strength of material bending stresses, we have already studied in our last module the shear force as well as the bending moment. And shear force means the algebraic sum of all the forces either on left side or on right side of a section of a beam. As well as bending moment means the algebraic sum of the moment of all the forces, that also we have studied. So how this shear force as well as the bending moment develop? This shear force and bending moment is developing in a beam when it is subjected to external forces. So a beam, when subjected to external forces, if it is bent up and form as a arc of a circle, then we can say that the beam is subjected to simple bending, otherwise pure bending. And when the beam bent up, otherwise deformed, when subjected to shear force as well as bending moment, an internal resistance will set up. And that internal resistance will be set up to resist the deformation that the beam may have undergo because of shear force and bending moment. And the deformation will stop when every section set up full resistance to the shear force and the bending moment acting on it. So bending stress is the stress induced to resist the bending moment. And shear stress and shearing stress, the stresses induced to resist the shear force. And the action of bending in a beam can say as a flexure. So we are going to make flexural formula also in this chapter. Now let us come to the concept of pure bending. For that, please consider this simply supported beam, and it is supported at end A and end B at a distance of A. From end A and end B, a load, pointed load of W is there, isn't it? And when we will draw the shear force diagram as well as the bending moment diagram, the shear force diagram will be look like this. This is the shear force diagram, SFD, and this is the BMD. Shear force diagram will look like this. It means there will be a load of W at support A, that will be a reaction at A, and a load of W at C also. It means the shear force is spread, W is spread from A to C, and at the other end B to D also, W is there, but it is minus. But for the case of AC, it is plus, and there is no shear force in between C and D. But for the case of bending moment diagram, WA is the bending moment, and it is constant from point C to point D, and the bending moment at the support A as well as support B is zero, as we are knowing. So a beam can be said to be subjected to pure bending when a pure bending has only normal bending stresses of tensile as well as the compressive nature. Whenever a beam subjected to ordinary bending, it may have both normal bending stresses as well as the shear stresses. But whenever it will subjected to pure bending, otherwise simple bending, then it will be having only bending stresses. Please note that. Now let us come to the theory of pure bending. Here, consider a simply supported beam and a cantilever beam. First is a simply supported beam, and it is both of it is having a uniformly distributed load. When this will be subjected to a load, the bending action from both end will be like this, and due to this way of orientation, otherwise the couple is acting like this, then we will get the bending form like this, and this way of forming is known as sagging. Otherwise this phenomena of bending is known as sagging, and the sagging we are taking as positive, that we have already studied in our bending moment last model, as well as when this beam of simply supported subjected to loading, then what will happen, that the central layer, which is known as neutral axis, the central layer is not going to subject any deformation. The central layer, whatever be the length, and it will be the same length after the deformation also, but after the deformation the beam will look like this shape for the case of a simply supported beam. It means that the beam will get compression at above the neutral axis, and it will subjected to tension below the neutral axis. So above the neutral axis, see, as per the diagram itself, it is revealing that the length is getting shortened, and below the neutral axis, the length of the layer is getting elongated, means it will subject to elastic. And for this case, the neutral axis NA will be having the same length, and it is not subjected to any kind of deformation. Now let us come to the cantilever beam. The cantilever beam, due to the weight, it will form like this after deformation, and this phenomena is known as hogging. And hogging, in last module we have taken it as negative, and after deformation the beam will look like this. The beam will look like this. It means the above the neutral axis, it will subjected to tension, and below the neutral axis, it will subjected to compression. And as opposite to the simply supported beam, in the case of a cantilever beam, the length of the layer above the neutral axis will increase, and the length of the layer below the neutral axis will decrease. For the theory of pure bending, one has to make some assumptions, and it is compulsory. So first is that the beam is is supposed to be homogeneous and isotropic. The homogeneous means that the beam is made up of same material throughout, and isotropic means elastic properties in all directions are same. And second is the beam is supposed to be straight, as well as of having uniform cross section before loading, and the material is stressed within its elastic limit. And the fourth assumption is that the transverse sections remains plane before and after the bending. And the fifth assumption is that the beam subjected to pure bending. And the sixth means each layer of the beam is free to expand or contract. And the seventh assumption is that the Young's modulus of elasticity of the material has same value in tension and compression. Now let us come to the derivation of flexural formula. Here, first of all, we are considering a slice ABCD. This is a slice ABCD we are considering of small length dx of simply supported beam subjected to bending moment M. So here we are considering a small slice ABCD. Okay, and see, EF is the neutral axis here, and AB is the topmost layer, and CD is the bottommost layer. And before loading, it will look like this. And after loading, then this will bend up like this. This is the beam after loading. And bend up beam, the length AB and CD will change to A1, B1 and G1, H1. And the neutral axis EF, sorry, it will be GH, we will concern afterwards. Neutral axis EF will be E1, F1 and bottom layer C1, D1, it will become. Now let us consider another layer at a distance Y from EF, neutral axis, that we named it as GH. And that layer GH will subjected to compression after the bending action. Okay. Now let us come to the points. After the bending up, one thing also I have to say, after bending up, then this will bend up like an arc of a circle. And let us say R is the radius of curvature and theta is the angle subtended in at the center. Okay. So we have said it, the small this distance dx, then what will happen here? Initially, AB and CD and EF will be dx. And the same way, GH also will be dx only. And length of the arc E1, F1 is equal to R theta. Why? Because EF is the neutral axis and the EF will be same as E1, F1 also, and this will be R theta, because the neutral axis is not subjected to any kind of deformation. And consider the layer GH. Now we have already told, consider the layer GH at a distance of Y. Then G1, H1 after bending will be less than that of GH. Now let us say E1, F1 is equal to EF is equal to GH is equal to R theta, that we are knowing. Now the length of the arc G1, H1, we have to find out. What will be the length of the arc G1, H1? The total radius of curvature up to the neutral axis is R, and from R it is from E1, F1, it is above the E1, F1. So it will be R minus Y into, radius will be R minus Y into theta. So the length of the layer GH is decreasing. What is the decrease in length of the layer GH? Initial length minus final length. That is GH minus G1H1. That is equal to R theta minus of R minus Y theta. That we will get reduced as R theta minus R theta plus Y theta. So we will get Y theta. Here we will get Y theta. Now strain in the layer GH. Let us calculate strain is E. Then E will be is equal to delta L upon L. So delta L we have already calculated as Y theta, and L is R theta. So this will be is equal to Y by R. Now strain is stress by modulus of elasticity, isn't it? Young's modulus, that is sigma by E. This y r, and from here the strain is sigma by E, so we can write it as sigma upon E is equal to Y by R. Otherwise we can write it as sigma by Y is equal to E by R. From this equation, E is proportional to Y. It means the strain of any layer is proportional to its distance from the neutral axis. So when Y will be zero, then strain will be zero. Now let us come to the concept that I have shown through a diagram here. See this diagram. Let us consider a small area delta L, a small area delta L at a distance of Y from the neutral axis. Okay, we are considering a small area delta A from a distance of Y from the neutral axis. So sigma will be E upon, sorry, E upon R into Y. From that equation, small force on this area let us consider, that is delta F. What is force? Force is stress into area, that is sigma into delta A. This sigma we have already written here as E upon R Y into delta A. Now let us consider moment of this small area. Let us say that this moment of this small area is delta M. Then delta M will be delta F multiplied by the distance Y, because it is at a distance of Y Then delta F we are having E upon R Y delta A into Y. It means E upon R delta A Y square. That is, for the case of total moment M, this will be sigma delta M. That is sigma E upon R delta A Y square. So take E upon R outside, then we will get sigma delta A Y square. So sigma delta A Y square is nothing but it is moment of inertia. Then when I will come this left side, M by I will be is equal to E by R. From the previous equation, we are knowing that E by R is equal to sigma Y. So we can write it as M upon I is equal to sigma y by div is equal to E by R, and this equation is known as the flexural equations. This equation is known as the flexural equation, and it is very important as far as regarding bending stresses. Now, moment of resistance. What is the moment of resistance? We will explain with the help of this diagram. And here it is the neutral axis passing through the center. It is a neutral axis. And the upper triangle is representing the compression zone. So this is sigma C. And the lower triangle is representing the tension zone. And the center of gravity will be, center of gravity here will be at a distance of Y C upon 3, and here the center of gravity will be at a distance of Y T by 3, and the distance in between the center of gravity of both of these is Z. Z is the lever arm. Z is the lever arm. Now, under the condition of equilibrium, if we assume that the system is under equilibrium, if it is in equilibrium, then T will be equal to C. It means C and T are the two equal, unlike, parallel, and non-collinear forces. Hence, they form a couple. The distance between the two forces of couple is called lever arm, and it is already said it is Z. Now, moment of couple, moment of couple is Z into C into Z. Otherwise, it can be equal to T into Z. And this one is known as the moment of resistance. And this is equal to moment of resistance. That is known as M suffix R. Now let us see the section modulus. Section modulus is represented as Z. And in flexural formula, we are having M is equal to sigma into I by Y, that we can write. So this can write as sigma into Z. So Z is here I upon Y. So moment of inertia, the section modulus, we can say ratio of moment of inertia to the section about the neutral axis and the distance of the most extreme fiber from the neutral axis. So Z is I by Y. I we are normally representing as M millimeter raised to 4, and M is in millimeter, so unit of this is millimeter cube, otherwise meter cube, otherwise centimeter cube, like that. If a rectangular section we are considering, for the case of a rectangular section, for a case of a rectangular section, then Z XX will be B D square divided by 6, and Z YY will be DB square divided by 6. And for the case of a circular section, ZXX will be pi by 32. It was d raised to 3, it will become d cube. And for the case of a polo circular section, Z axis will be pi by 32 into d raised to 4 minus d raised to 4 divided by d. So remembering these things will be very helpful while we will be attending the questions. And also the maximum bending moment also we will note here. Maximum bending moment. If there is a simply supported beam like this, and at the center if it is having a load W, L by 2, then maximum moment will be WL divided by 4, and it will be of sagging nature. And for the same case, if there is a uniformly distributed load, same of simply supported beam, and length and all are the same, then MC will be is equal to WL square divided by 8 And for the case of a cantilever beam, which is having a pointer load W here at the end, here, if this is A and this is B, sender is C and sender is C, and here it is A, here it is B, and here it is A, here it is B, and C we have calculated, and here MA will be is equal to WL, and it will be of fogging nature, because this and the previous one will be of sagging nature, and consider the cantilever which is having a uniformly distributed load at the up to the end B, then in that case MA will be is equal to WL square divided by 2. This also will be of fogging nature. Remembering these equations may help you to solve the problem very easily, and also it is very much needed also. And if you could understand this well, you can subscribe my channel and also like my video and share with your friends. Thank you for watching.